Amen, amen, all of them, amen. It's good to see you this morning. I don't know, I'm glad it's spring break. This is the last Sunday of it, praise the Lord. Somebody needs to break spring break or something, I don't know. Get everybody doing it the same week. Maybe that would work. It's good to see you today, though. We're in our series of messages, which is entitled Higher. You know, hopefully you've been moving up as we go. The fourth message is out of Mark, and I've titled it Called Up. Y'all know what it means to be called up, don't you? For those guys that are old like me, when they used to have the draft, you knew what that meant to be called up, right? He got called up. If you're in the military, you should know what called up is. Amen. We were called up. We had to get there. At the same time, there's a passage out of the book of Mark which shows those first disciples when they were called up. So we're going to look at that text today. And remember, we've started each one of these messages with four questions. And I want to look at those four questions once again. And if you've been here for each of these services, the answer for the first question ought to be different every Sunday. Amen. Frank's awake. And Frank's half deaf and he heard me. You know, when you get back, where am I in my life, in my walk with Jesus, in my walk of faith, where am I right now? And, you know, so we asked this question last Sunday, and we asked it the Sunday before. So when you sit back two Sundays ago and you answered that question, hopefully you're drifting in the right direction, all right? You're going up. You're moving farther out, and you're looking and you say, well, praise God, man, 2 weeks ago when you asked that question, that's where I was. I am not there today. Praise God. Yeah, two of you. That's a start. One to two. We'll be shooting for three on the next one. Where am I? Where am I in my walk with God? Exactly where I am? And that following that is the obvious question, you know, where's God leading me? What is there in my life that God has put his hand on, he's calling me up to, he's calling me out to, he's leading me to? And I believe that, you know, if we'll take some time with Jesus, he'll give us those answers where we're headed. We know in the long run where we're headed, amen. We're going to be called up. Hallelujah. We're going to be, y'all going to have to wake up. This is not working. All right. You know, I take a long time to preach if you're not with me. So catch up and we'll all get called up. There is that day when the Lord and that last trumpet sounds and we are going to be called up. Now, the third one is, you know, if I'm still back there where I was when I asked that question 2 weeks ago, what's my problem? What really is hindering me? And we've dealt with the last couple of Sundays how to deal with that issue and what's hindering us. And you know, the next is, I believe, an obvious that then what are these next steps? If this is where the Lord's taking me, then what's required of me now? What's God saying to me? Now, this whole idea of going higher is a biblical concept. If you want to take some time and do an interesting study, you know, just look at the hires in the Word of God. Look at the upward calls in the Word of God. Go to all those passages on mountains, how the Lord has set our feet on the high places and how God has even made the most difficult of the mountains a highway that we can walk on. He equips us, and we read that passage last week. He's made our feet like hinds feet. We can walk even the most difficult places. As the Lord calls us up, it doesn't matter how bad or how difficult the terrain might be. Our passage today is found in just a few verses we'll look at in the book of Mark in chapter 3. And this is one of those places in the Bible, if you just kind of read and you got to kind of get over it real quick, you need to slow down here, all right? In fact, it'd help in all your Bible reading times to slow down. That's a good tip, all right? But listen to what he says. And he says, it's that he went up on the mountain and summoned those who he himself wanted, and they came to him. And he appointed the 12 so that they would be with him, and he could send them out to preach and to have authority to cast out the demons, and he appointed the 12. Now, if you're following the ministry of Jesus at this point in time, he's already doing some phenomenal things. I mean, miracles are happening. Thousands and thousands of people coming from all over. The word is spread out far and wide about this guy who's casting out demons and healing the sick. And miraculous things are happening. He's already had some encounters with some of the disciples who will be a part of the 12. All right, but he hadn't done that official ordination service and appointing service until right here and right now. And this is where it's taking place. Now, if you read back Mark 1 and 2, you'll see there's just, again, there is a lot of people who are around because they're seeing what's going on. But then he reaches out and he does something very unique by calling these 12 unto himself. It says, you know, he went up on the mountain and there he summoned them. because those whom he wanted, he himself wanted, and they came to him. By the way, before I even get into all this, I think that's a good place to stop before I get into point one, two, three. There's three important things I want to say about this. But just think for a moment. Are there any more inspiring words that he called those to himself who he himself wanted? There's a lot of people down there, all right? And he's calling. And he's calling to himself those he wanted. Listen, if God has put his hand on you, I mean, if you've come to Christ, you have heard that call to come to the Savior. You've heard the call to be born again. You've heard the call to give your life to Jesus Christ. What could be more exciting? What could be more enrapturing? What could be more powerful? What could instill more inspiration in you than that? He called those he wanted. He called Joe because he wanted Joe with him. Blows my mind. Some of y'all didn't have your coffee. I mean, again, let's linger here. Don't miss this. I mean, if you're looking for a word of inspiration from the pastor today, it's not going to get much better than that. He called you because he wanted to be with you. He wanted you to be with him. Hallelujah. We're going to dwell on that a little bit more in a moment, but I don't want you to pass it right here and right now when he makes this. Those who he wanted, he called them up to himself. That's true. I mean, we ought to have a tremendous amount of confidence in our spiritual walk in life. I'm not talking about a good self-esteem. I'm talking about spiritual confidence here in Christ. Man, I can do whatever God's called me. I'm with him. He wanted to be with me. Me, of all people in the world, why in the world would he pick me? It's not relevant. He wanted. That's all that matters. All right? That's what he wanted to do. Now, I love, because Scripture goes on to make this very clear, and this is an important note, an important part, because it says that, you know, if he's called you unto himself and he's laid his hand on your life, that, hey, that settles the issue. You're going to make it. All right? You're going to get there. The Bible says, faithful is he that calleth you. It also goes on to say, he that began a good work in you, he will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. That's some glorious stuff. I mean, that God has made that kind of call to my life because he just wanted fellowship with Joe. That's more than I can say for some of you. Amen. Look around the room. How many people have been calling you this week? Jesus is the Son of God, the Son of glory, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, the President of all presidents has got your number and he's calling you. Why does he want me? He just wants you. He likes you. In fact, the Bible says, for God so loved you that he gave his only begotten Son. Now listen, folks, this is something you just got to wrap your heart and your mind around. I really believe it is transformative. He called you, therefore he's committed to you, therefore he's responsible for you. He says he's going to get you there. He began the good work. He's going to stick right to it. He's going to stick right with you. He's going to carry you through the end. Now the important part is that they came, all right? You don't miss that part. They came. They came. And where are they going, all right? And, by the way, don't even miss this. It says he went up where? Lots of mountains in the Bible, as I said. We got Sinai, we got Horeb, Mount Transfiguration, most important of all, Mount Calvary. And if we're going to walk with that's where we have to go first. We've got to come to the cross where we find forgiveness of our sins, redemption, salvation, deliverance from our sins, and holiness unto the Lord. God gives us what we need to live from. So we come first of all up. Isn't it amazing? The Lord never is calling us down. He's calling us up. Where are you? You know what God's wanting for your life? He wants to bring you up. He wants to bring you higher. He wants to bring more into your life. He wants to bring fullness. I've come, you might have life abundantly. That means up. So as we respond to what God says to us, and as we listen to these sermons this week, it ought to be something to realize, hey, he's calling me away and up to something better. He called him up on the mountain. You know, I'm just a little curious. I got this great computer program. I've got about every Greek and Hebrew dictionary in it and everything you can, you know, add to it. And, you know, so I don't have to get up and go pull out 40 books like you used to have, lay them all open. I just click, 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 click. And I said, well, you know, everybody knows what a mountain is, but just out of curiosity, let's see what the Greek definition for mountain is. Click. You know what it means, literally from the Greek language? Oh, you're going to love this. I had to have a little shout and spell, get up and walk around my desk once. Above the plain. Obviously, right? But hey, think about it. Some of y'all have been plain so long, you're starting to look vanilla. Yeah? Above the plain, above the ordinary, above the routine, above the dread, the dull, the dry. Above it all. Higher. That's where God's bringing us up to. Some of you are so busy trying to fit in, but you need to realize where you're trying to fit in is lower. You know? And it's popular to be lower. But it's miserable. It's mundane. It's plain. And what's God doing? He's calling us above the plain. Above all the fray, above the ordinary, above the average, above the usual, above the nominal, above mediocrity. Isn't that where our life is supposed to be? You're walking with Jesus, hey, life is not nominal and life is not usual. Life is radically crazy when you're walking with Jesus. All kinds of bizarre stuff is going on when you're walking above the plain. But this is where he calls it. It says he called them up in verse 14. He says, and he appointed them. In other words, he's doing something here. Now, your Bible may say he ordained them. It's the same word in the Greek language, appoint, ordain. All right? But the idea here is that God's doing something with these guys. He has a purpose for them. He has a plan for them. There's something that's in the big, broad plan of a sovereign God that's going to involve puny little people, which is good to know our one. God's got something big he wants to do with our lives, and he brings these normal, everyday, average Joes, so to say, all right? He brings them unto himself. Fishermen, tax collectors, just from every walk, every call, everything you can imagine, come up here. And it says he appoints them. Now, this word is also another unusual word in the Greek language. You know, this word has to do with it's the word poeo in the Greek language. I'm clicking, but let's see what happens here. Frank, click it one time for me, would you? He calls them up to himself, and it says, and there, when they get there, he appoints them. Not working for you either, is it? There we go. The word is poeo, and this word is unique. It's used in lots of different forms in the Greek language. One of the places that I've always loved and found this word, it was in Ephesians 2, 8, and 10. We know 8 and 9 says we're saved by grace through faith, not of ourselves, not of works, lest any man should boast, all right? But verse 10 says, and we are his workmanship, created unto good works. All right. The word workmanship is the word poeo with the M-O-N in, poemo. And it's poemo, it's the word we get from the English language, poem from, all right? God is crafted. God's crafting us. God's shaping us. You know, we're like a beautiful poem in the hands of God as God shapes our life. All right? But the idea here, that word poemo, we got a word poem from, comes from this. In other words, it's not just that God, okay, go do this. There's something that God is working in us, designing us, crafting us for. We are his workmanship. His hand is upon our life. And so when God says he appoints us, ordains what everyone, it means that God's put his hand on our life, but not just to lay his hand, but he lays his hand upon us for a reason, for purpose, for there's something that God is going to do is the idea here. That's why we say the word literally means to make or to do, used either way. Now, for the believer, it's something he's making us to do something. He's working us. He's gifting us. He's recreating us. He's transferring. We get a new heart. We get a new life. We get a new mind. We're born again. New creations in Christ. God's doing something phenomenal in your life. So understand, you may look normal to everybody else, but you ain't. You are quite unique, and you are quite different than anything this world knows that can come out of the world. And each one of those little craftsman's workmanship little things that God is doing in our life, we're all different in that even. We're all unique in that. So he ordains them, and then he gives us three reasons why he does this. When he gets to verse 14, when he says this, so he appointed the 12 that they, and he gives three reasons. Let's look at what they are, and let's break it down pretty simple. First of all, it has to do with communion. He says he appoints them, and it just simply says that they might be with him. Gotta love that. Because the same is true for us. It's communion. Lindy's been doing a great job on 1 John on Wednesday nights. And this last week before last, he talked about again the out of 1 John 1, it says that when John is speaking, he says, you know, hey, we've experienced, we've tasted, we've seen the Word of God, we've handled the Word of life. And he goes on to, and he says, you know, but not only we handle the Word of life, we're telling you about Him so that you may have fellowship like we have fellowship. The goal here, he said, was we're writing you this letter so you can have communion. So you can have a walk with God, so you can experience this relationship. But ultimately, it just says three words here, be with Him. First call of all things that God's called you to or does in your life, you say, what's God's will for my life? Where God's telling me? Hey, this is it right here. First and foremost, and this has to be the priority of all the things that you feel God's leading you to do. This has to be number one, to spend time with Him, to be with Him. Now, unfortunately, in the church today, we give a long list of to everybody of all the things they're supposed to be doing, and this is usually left off somewhere. Order number one for the day. Rule number one for the day. Job number one for the day. Be with Jesus. Be with Jesus. Be. Again, the English language is not like the Greek language, the Hebrew language, which have so many other words for so many other things. With English, it's just be. But that's pretty good, you know. I can't really be without Jesus. You've heard me use a little term before, you know. If you don't know Jesus, you're just kind of like a hunk of warm meat walking around. You're not being. And we can't really be until we've been born again. We can't really be. We can't really live. We're just existing before we really give our hearts and life to Christ. We're not really being. We can't even be a human being. Unless we're in Jesus. Then we have our life, as the Apostle Paul said on Mars Hills, and our being is in Him. So we be. Our existence is up in it. But the Greeks, I say, remember, they have lots of words for different things. This particular word for being here, it's similar to the word that Jesus uses when He says, I am, but it's not the same. This word here for be with Him is the word which has the idea of departure with it. To be with. It's one word, be with in English. But the idea here is that if He moves from this spot, I'm moving with Him. If He goes over there, I'm going over there. If He goes over there, I'm going over there. If He comes this way, I'm coming this way. If He goes that way, I'm going that way. I'm going to, well, I guess what it means, be with, right? In other words, He didn't just call them up on the mountain to sit there and just stay there, and that's the end of it. Oh, come be with me. No, the be is a constant movement of your life. I'm walking with Jesus, and where He is where I are. And I really aren't are. I'm really not if He's not in my life. I'm not experiencing the fullness of life if I'm not experiencing it in Him. So the very first order for the Christian life is to be with Him. It's simple, it's glorious, it's profound. You know, it's with Him. Now, obviously, He's up on the mountain. He's above the plain. He's above the fray. 1 Corinthians, Paul's writing the church. And in this letter, he says, listen, understand this. It starts the letter out this, 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Gets down about verse 9, and after making some salutary greetings and stuff, he says, now, God is faithful. Good words to start your letter with, amen? God is faithful. Now, catch these next words. By whom you were called into fellowship with His beloved Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. God called you into fellowship. God called you into fellowship with His Son. And He's faithful. God is faithful. So what do I need? If I need consistency in my spiritual life, I'm going to find it in Christ. If I need strength in my spiritual life, I'm going to find it in Christ. If I need endurance in my spiritual life, I'm going to find it in Christ. If I need overcoming power over some particular sin in my life, I'm going to find it in Jesus Christ. Order number one, rule number one, concept number one, principle number one is get with Jesus daily. It's the priority of all priorities. It's the central thing of all things. You know, you get people to attend church. You can get people to read their Bible sometimes. You can get people to maybe pass out a gospel tract. But get people to Jesus. And to be with Jesus. And to walk with Jesus. And to spend time with Jesus. And to let Him be the focal point. I mean, even in our last study that we did in our series on James, verse 8 of chapter 4, draw nigh unto God, He will draw nigh unto you. be with Christ. It's really the very first thing in the series of events that he even calls them to. You must first walk with him. You must first worship him. And again, this isn't yesterday, last month. It's just today I'm going to live in Christ. And if I choose now, if I can get this in my head and say, today I'm going to live with Christ. Today I'm going to walk with Christ. Today's his day. Today he's my Lord. Today he's my friend. Today he's my brother. Today he's my king. And today I'm going to live with him. Boy, your perspective begins to change throughout today. You see things differently. It becomes the focus of your life. I remember, I guess it's 90s or somewhere, I was all excited about buying this new car. You know, we get about stuff sometimes. And I wanted a Jeep Cherokee. They'd come out with this new body style for the Jeep Cherokee. And I wanted a red one. You know, we get about cars and stuff, right? So I bought me a red Jeep Cherokee because, hey, nobody had a red Jeep Cherokee until I bought one. I drove off the lot. Everybody had a red Jeep Cherokee. Do you notice you ever do that? You buy something like that, get a new truck. I'll get that color. Everybody's got that color. Everywhere you look, oh, that's another red Jeep Cherokee. This is, boy, you talk about the plane. It's a plane. But in that truck, I could say to you today, I want you to look around this room and pick out everything that is green. All of a sudden, all kinds of green stuff starts popping up everywhere you hadn't paid attention. Well, you got a green mindset all of a sudden. But let's just take that in the simplest form and say, let's get a Jesus mindset today. We'll start seeing God in all kinds of stuff. We thought it was a traffic jam. All the time it was God just doing something in your life. You thought it was an irritating person who works with you every day, who's always that same obnoxious. And now you're going to start seeing Jesus in all that situation. You're just going to start Jesus in the temptation. You'll start seeing Jesus in the problems, Jesus in the blessing. All of a sudden you got this new perspective and it's just Jesus, Jesus. Why? Because, hey, I'm with Jesus today. Who are you with? I've seen the shirts. I'm with stupid, you know. Get you and say, I'm with Jesus. Maybe they're pointing into your heart or something, you know. Because if you're with Jesus today, guess what? School's going to happen in school. It's going to be different. Guess what happens at work? It's going to be different. But it's coming back to the place and saying, hey, Jesus called my name. Can you imagine these 12 guys? There's thousands of people. Read the story. Thousands of people around. He called my name. He called me. Doesn't that blow your mind? He put your name there. He called you. But that doesn't stop there, praise. But it starts there. And it, most importantly, it starts there because it's from there that we'll see that the rest of this kind of flows. He says the second thing is that they would be with him. And the second thing, that he might send them to preach. And that's that great word, caruso. Just publish. Just talk about it. That's all it means. Just to talk about it. You're the PR person. I mean, it's all about telling people about the Lord, telling people what God's up to, who God is, what he's done, about his word. How he moves, how he operates, what he's done in you. I praise the Lord. We have lots of kind of programs that are out there. There's one called Christian Witness Training, Evangelism Explosion. We're doing some stuff in our lift groups. If you're missing lift group right now, you're really missing something really to sharpen your spiritual sword in your life. It's on just being a personal witness and how to use your own testimony in your life and what God's done in your own life to share with other people. It's all about, it all comes down to this. It's one of the things God called me to do. So, he called me to be with him. Now, let me ask you this question. Do you think that's optional, that part about being with him? No, because that's the crux of the whole deal, is it not? How about this second part, and that he might send them to preach? It's not optional either. It's just package deals, part of what I do. It's not what I do really as much as what I am. I am a Christian. I am a believer. And as a believer, you know, it's just... It's kind of like, how many have a dog in your house? Does your dog meow? No, your dog doesn't go meow, meow. Your dog, woof, 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 right? Why does he do that? It's just stupid sounding, is it not? Looks stupid on you, wouldn't it? Looks stupid on me. He's a dog. Dogs do that. Guess what Christians do? They open their mouth for Jesus. It's part of the Bible says he's made us that way. He made us ambassadors of reconciliation. He calls us ministers. Calls us salt. Calls us light. He doesn't say act like salt. He just says be salt. You are salt. You are the salt. He says you are the light. Doesn't say act like light. I mean, how do you act like light anyway? I don't know. There's got to be something you can do. You are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. Quit grunting and groaning. It's what you are. God made that way. So just go do it. So I don't know how to. You don't have to know how. It's what you are. You just do it. It comes out. Well, Jesus told Peter, don't worry about what you're going to say. Especially when you stand before dignitaries. It's still the same. Dignitaries, poor people, rich people, sad people, happy people, salt. So just do it. I'll give you whatever you need in that moment. I'm living it. By the way, you're with me. So don't worry about it. You know? You've been going to some place you're not supposed to be in because you hadn't got the recognition, the notoriety or fame or whatever, but you can turn around and say, hey, I'm a so-and-so. I'm with the band. I get backstage, I'm with the band. You're with Jesus. You're with Jesus. I remember some of the best advice I ever got was from Mickey Bonner, I think it was, who told me this. And my brother reiterated later. When I first started taking Israel trips, it's kind of a frightening thing going to that part of the world, going through all the stuff you have to go through and putting everything together and doing that. And I was told this, you know, it says, there are real sticklers in that part of the world about rules and regulations. I don't care where you are or what you're doing, whether you're in the Arab quarter, or in the, you know. So here's the key thing you got to know what to do. You don't have to know what to do. Just act like you do. Just act like you know what you're doing. You'll be okay. I found that to be quite true. I've used it my whole life in ministry since then. I mean, the first time we went to Belize, and Terry Acker and I and some other people, we went to Belize, and we decided we're going to go to the park, and we're going to set up our little band we had, and we're going to preach. And they told us, you know, when we got there, where's your permit? Cop asked me, he said, you can't set up, we're setting equipment up. You know, I said, oh, I got permission. Where's your permit? I got permission. He said, who gave permission? I said, Jesus gave me permission. And that blew me away to start with. People don't handle that, do they? Jesus gave me permission. He said, I said, what's your name? He said, Gabriel. There you go. Sent me an angel to help. He helped me unload the truck, helped Terry and I set the equipment up. Just act like you know what you're doing. Because you made that way. Hey, guess what? You look over your shoulder, hey, did I do that? You say the oracle thing, did I do that? Yeah, you just won that person to Jesus. But it wasn't you, so don't get a big head. It was Jesus who did that in you. It's the whole idea, hey, he has called me to do something. And with the whole idea, it's the word, we get the word apostle from it in the original language. It's the word apostello. It's the same Greek word that Jesus uses in Luke 4 when he's announcing to everybody in the synagogue in the first days of his ministry why he came. And he gets up, remember, and he reads out of Isaiah, and he says, you know, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim the release to the captives, recovery sight to the blind, those who are downtrodden. He just sent, I've been sent. People sit back and say, you know, this guy acts like he's got authority. So do you. You've been sent. And that's the actual word has to do with somebody who's been sent on a mission like a dignitary. That's the way this word was used. A little while later, we'll look and see where it says Jesus sent them, and then he gives them authority to send as well. That's a different word. But it's in the English, again, a little limited here, send and send. In other words, my sending, your sending means you have the approval. You have the badge. You have whatever it is. You have the pass. You have the permission. Whatever it is God's called, you don't have to worry about it. You don't have to sweat the showers. You don't have to worry about the weather. You don't have to worry about people's language. You're called. You have the seal of approval. You've got the FDA stamp. You've got the license. You have the liberty. You got it when he sent. When he said, go do this, that meant you can. I don't think I can. Yes, you can. If I'm not gifted, doesn't anything do with it. I haven't got the personality. Doesn't anything do with personalities. I don't have the talent. Doesn't anything do with talent. Nothing whatsoever to do with any of that. What's it have to do with? He told me to come. Here I am. He sent me over here. And I'm here because he told me that. And I can't tell how many times I have used that as my introduction and witness. You know, the Lord told me to tell you something. What? Who told you? The Lord, in my heart, God just told me to tell you something. What? You've been commissioned for this. You've been delegated for this. You have the official seal of approval. Now, the Great Commission. Now, you say, well, let's speak about this textually, Brother Joe. He's talking to the disciples about their ministry. Let's talk about it contextually as well. When at the end of his ministry on the earth, he speaks to all those disciples gathered around that were watching him ascend, and he says, you go into all the world, make disciples of all nations, all men. Same task, same responsibility. And what you're going to do is I just have this lifestyle of speaking, publicizing, talking about Jesus. It's just part of who you are. Well, I don't know how. Anything to it. People don't talk about Jesus because they don't know how. They don't talk about Jesus because they haven't got back to point number one. They don't spend any time with Jesus. The more you spend time with him, the more you want to talk about him. The more he's the focus of your life, the more you want to talk about him. The more you're committed in that the privacy of your heart and life of communing with the Lord Jesus Christ, you know, the more you want to talk about him. I mean, what happened in Isaiah 6? This great man of God is broken before God, sees this great revelation of the glory, glory, glory of God. The angel saying, holy, holy, holy. And he says, oh, man of unclean lips. Now, has he been cussing? He said, I look well in the midst of people. I think he's been talking about everything but what he's supposed to be talking about. In fact, it was his commissioning as a prophet to speak about God. And I think for us to have unclean lips means that we don't speak what we ought to be speaking. It may not be profanity. It might not be cursing. It might not even be gossip. But it's not what it ought to be, which is about Jesus. And then you say, what makes you think that? Because the Lord said, whom shall I send to preach, to speak up? And he said, me. Send me. I'll go. Now, folks, understand. The whole issue here is that he's met with God. What comes out of that? I want to talk. My lips have been made clean. My heart's been made right. Now I'm ready to talk about Jesus. So if Jesus doesn't occupy your speech in the context of how you relate to people, then maybe it's because we're not really spending the time with him, and that commissioning is not happening in our life, or at least the obligation of speaking from the commissioning is happening because our communion is not really being right with Christ. Everything moves out from him. In him, the apostle said, Marcia, in him we move, we live, we have our being. Everything flows. All things are from him, and all things are to him, and all things are through him, of him. I mean, he's the divine derivation of all things. And it says all things are through. He's the divine dynamic. Our life has power because we spend time with him. Look at the life of the testimony of Jesus. But also it tells us that all things are going to him. In other words, he's the divine destination. So we have the divine derivation, the divine dynamic, and the divine destination. I think Bill Stafford puts it away. He's the source, the force, and the course. He's the source, so I spend time with him. He's the force, so I have my commissioning from him. He's the course. He tells me exactly where to go. Everything moves out of him. And the third point here, move on with this. It's this issue of conflict. He says, I want you to have authority over the enemy. Cast out demons. You send them out. I'll send you. You send them. Don't you like that? God sent me. So devil, get out of here. I send you out of here. It might be best to pause for just a moment and let me just insert this. You never go higher without a conflict in the spiritual realm. You're never going to go higher without a conflict. And some people say, I'm committing it to Jesus. I'm going to be what God be called me. And they go out and they face conflict immediately. Oh, it's going to be so hard. And it's going to be so difficult. It's hard, Pastor. It's hard. It's so hard. You don't know how hard it is. It's hard. It's real hard. You only know how hard it was. It's so hard to even tell you about it. There's conflict in the spiritual. Hey, listen, you know, God didn't call us into heaven. We're marching through hell every day. Heaven's coming. Jesus, in this world, there's going to be tribulation. There's going to be fights. There's going to be turmoil. You're fighting against spiritual forces and wickedness in high places, you know. Satan hates you. Just because you got saved, I mean, he hung up the flag. I go, well, don't mess with him anymore. No, when you got saved, he wrote your name in bold letters on the chalkboard in hell and said, get him. Get her. Don't let her get free. Don't let her get loose. She'll change the world. Jesus said, I want you to go out and set. As I set people free, you set people free. So you cast out the enemy. You destroy the very source of the problem they have. The source of their problem is Satan. The source of our life is Jesus. One leads to life. One leads to death. Which one do you want to be a part of? See, it's, again, one of the aspects of this whole idea of that I've come to Christ, one of the aspects of my redemption is victory over the devil. First John, he came to destroy the works of the devil. The word exousia, when he talks about, a while ago we talked about it as apostello, the sending out, as dignitaries. Here's another word which means to send out, but it's this, you know, he says, I give you authority to send out. The word for send out there is ekbalo. The word for authority is the word exousia, which gets back to that whole delegation, dignitary kind of mindset, you know, that God's put his hand on you and you have permission to be used by him. So I don't have to go to ask anybody, say, can I tell you about Jesus? I already have permission. All right? I don't have to kind of sheepishly say, would it be all right if I gave you this little gospel tract? I already have permission. I already have authority. I don't have to ask permission. And when Satan sticks his ugly head in there, I have permission to say, get lost. Get out of here. Be gone. Where's that come from? I'm with him. Heard the old statement, when Jesus knocks on the door, I mean, when the devil knocks on the door of your life, let Jesus answer. You're always bringing up, you know, be that name dropper of Jesus is my Lord, Jesus is my King. I have every right to share with you at any time God tells me to, because he told me to. And not only told me to, he gave me the power to be, and it's that word not so much with dynamite, like explosive power, that Greek word dunamis, but this is that word exousia, which means it is a delegated privilege, a delegated authority, a delegated responsibility, but it's also not just here's the purpose you'll fulfill, but here's the power to fulfill the purpose. Here's what you need. I'll give you what you need. Well, okay, I'll take it. Where is it? It's you got it when you got saved. So you don't have to wait around for feelings. You don't have to wait for a note from your mother. You just go and be what God's called you to be. And in going, you're going to have to deal with the enemy. But in dealing with the enemy, you just send him on his way. How do you do that? On your way, in Jesus' name. And much of prayer has to do with this as well. You know, because the prayer is where we really pull down the strongholds that are spiritual like that. In prayer, I rebuke the devil. In prayer, I renounce the enemy. People say, well, when you're talking to the devil like that, isn't that praying to the devil? No. I pray to Jesus. I tell the devil what to do. You've heard me use the illustration before. You know, when you tell a cat to get out of your way, scat, you know, you're not praying to the cat. Right? You're just invoking some authority. Get out of my way. It's the same thing in your spiritual life. What is it right now that seems to be the big hindrance? Get it out of your way. How do you get it out of your way? Jesus said, whatever the obstacle, like a mountain, he said, if it's getting in your way, you speak to it. Say, be gone in Jesus' name. Well, how do I know that anything is going to happen at that point? God said it would. I know that today, if I have a lost loved one, and I'm praying today for that lost loved one, that Satan be bound from blinding them and from binding them. It's got this two ministries in lost people's life to bind and bind. If he's doing that, I can rebuke that today in their life so that the Spirit of God, when he ministers that person is going to hear it and they're going to know it. Now, if they don't receive it today, guess what I get to do again tomorrow? I get to bind the enemy again in the name of Jesus and rebuke the enemy again in the name of Jesus. And I'll do that daily until this individual finally gets right with God. Amen. Might not be this year, might not be this month, might be today. We don't know. That's God's business. My business is to pull my sword and stand in battle, praying and believing God. That's my responsibility. So I've been, first of all, what's the source of all everything I need? It's in Jesus. I get to be with Jesus. Number two, all right, communion first. Number two is commission. Now that I am with Jesus, we're going to do some things together. We're going to march forward together. So there's this cooperation with God's commission on my life. And now as I go forward that, then, hey, I've got some obstacles that I'm going to have to deal with, so I do it by the authority that God's given me in the name of Jesus. So I understand, again, he is the source of my strength. So I spend time with him. He's given me this course that I'm going to live in today, and that's out into the world to be used by him. So I'll follow the course as I rely upon the source, and guess what I'll discover? I'll discover the force that I need, the strength that I need, the power that I need to be what God's called me to be. That's a good sermon. I don't say that about all my sermons. So you don't even have to tell me today that was a good sermon. I already know. That's a word from God for us. It'll change our lives. if we get serious about it. No matter where you are in your walk, you ready to go higher? That's a word from God that will transform your walk in life. I believe with all my heart we go through times, all right? We'll go through seasons of dryness and you know, it's like winter time and summer time in our spiritual walk in life. I feel for many of you, there's been this kind of winter going on in your own, not just physically, but maybe even on your spiritual life. But the spring is here. And I believe that we're on the verge as a church of God doing something really phenomenal in our midst. And I think it'd be very terrible if we miss this opportunity that God's giving us. I believe that no matter where you are in life, your age, your whatever category you might fall into, you think you fall into, I feel almost like the children of Israel come up to the Jordan River and God's telling them to cross it and go on the other side. You know, and Joshua finally leads them across. I feel like we're at that point. We need to cross that next river. We need to cross that next valley. We need to cross that next thing and step on in and go a little further than we've been before. As individuals, but even as a church. Now, I really feel so committed to this. That you need to understand, somebody came to me one time and said, "You just preach with an agenda." I said, "Well, duh." The Word of God has an agenda. You know, what's the agenda? I want you to be what God wants you to be. I want to be what God wants me to be. That's not a hidden agenda, all right? I talk about it every Sunday. I want us to be what God calls us to be. But for some of us, we have to realize there's some radical steps of action that are going to be taking place. Some of you have drifted into a spiritual lethargy, and you've gotten comfortable being nothing and doing nothing. And a sacrifice is going to be made before you break that in your life. That sacrifice is you coming to the Lord and presenting yourself again to the Lord and saying, "God, I'm stuck in the plane. It's time to rise above the plane. I'm stuck in mediocrity. I love the Lord. I'm coming to church. I'm giving, I'm tithing. But where is that part of that being with Him?" We do things as a church. We have an agenda as a church to help us stay fresh and to stay alive and to come back to the place of commitments and come back to the place of, well, let's use the word, it's not used often these days, revival. If you read my e-blast just last week or so, I was talking about how I follow a thread on LinkedIn. Some of you are familiar with LinkedIn, and it's a pastoral link on there. And it was among Baptists, and they were talking about why churches in general don't have revivals anymore. And I believe ultimately it's because churches today, we're kind of that Laodicean age. We don't want to put anybody out. We don't want to ask anybody to do anything above and beyond the call. We don't want to, you know, put any stress on anybody. People are busy. People are working. People drive 25 minutes, 35 minutes, 40 minutes to work. People have got all these reasons why we don't do anything that's extracurricular. But I do believe, folks, there are times in our life we need to get a little extracurricular. At times when we need to draw ourselves aside and really focus on the Word of God, really focus on the will of God. That's why we have conferences. That's why we do revivals. That's why we have retreats, you know, whether it's women or men. For you to, you know, say, "Hey, I need an extra spark in my life. I need an extra inspiration. I need an extra, you know, something to move me forward, to move me up higher. I need to get something from God." And I believe that as we stand here on the brink of a blessing, God's doing something in this community. It's getting ready to explode here in the next 24 months, population-wise. And many of those people need Jesus. Many of them are going to just need churches. I believe God called us to minister to this community, then we need to be doing everything we can to minister to it and reaching as many people as possible in every home possible as the Lord allows us to do that. But our hearts have to be on fire. There needs to be a passion that motivates us. You know, I'm not interested in growing a church by trading members with Spring Baptist or something. You know, I call that sheep thievery. You know, we give birth to our own little baby sheep, amen? Have our own flock that God's called us to reach people for Christ. Your friends at school, your friends at work, your friends in your neighborhood, they can be saved. Whenever we get that part, well, they don't want to be saved, they don't want to care, they don't want to hear the Bible, they don't want to hear prayer, then we've really disconnected with the Lord. Jesus said, what he said with Luke, he said, "Listen, I came to set people free." And everywhere you look around you, there's people in bondage. At your work, just look at, I mean, pull it from me and say, man, there really are. You would agree with me, wouldn't you? There's a lot of people in bondage. People you don't even know what they're going through that you work with. Their homes are in strife. They're in turmoil. They're on the edge of divorce. They're going through hassles. Their kids are being faced with all kinds of temptations. Some little girl somewhere is thinking about, well, am I going to give into this thing and give into immorality and, you know, lose my virginity? I mean, everybody else is. And they're fighting all these struggles. Am I going to do drugs? Am I going to get drunk? Am I going to do what everybody else is doing? Am I going to cheat on my taxes? There's all kinds of conflicts that are going on all around us. And people are in bondage. Many of them, they say, I want to do the right thing, and they keep falling flat on their face. Because the key again goes back to where? To be with Jesus. Starts there. How many kids are around you? How many people are around you? How many parents are around you? You know they're struggling. And they're just looking, you know, they're looking, they don't even know what they're looking for. I mean, the world will tell you that people aren't looking for answers. Just they are. Probably more than any other time. That's why they're buying into everything the world spits out there. Well, if you had this house, you had this car, you had this job, you had this title, you had this, you'd be happy. You know, buy these clothes, wear these shoes, really. People are looking for answers. And guess what? We are the answers. Isn't that good enough? The Church of Jesus Christ, we're the answers. We're here with the light, we're here with the salt. A couple of weeks from now, we're going to be going into a men's retreat, just a few days on a weekend. I'm praying it will be a phenomenal, supernatural time where men get a meeting with God. We're going to work poor Cecil Peasley to death, all right? It was 74, I think, something like that by now. I don't know. I mean, we put Bill Stafford through this a couple years ago. I think he hadn't got back into ministry yet. 5 days. A few days there at the retreat. And then Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday here at the church. Your opportunity to reach out and touch people's lives. Reach people, minister to people. Tell them, hey, we got a special event. Man, we got a deal going through. You can come see this deal. You know, come see what's happening. Invite them. No, people don't come to church anymore. Well, because nobody invites them to church anymore. Well, I asked them 2 years ago. I'll ask them again. Amen? Now, here's the invitation. It's pretty simple today. I believe with all my heart God wants to do something very special with our church. Not just we as individuals going a step higher. I think God's calling our church to go higher. Let's go deeper. Let's go further. Let's step out. Let's walk with Jesus on a new plane. Starts with individuals, yes. But as a church, we corporately work together. I'm gonna encourage, you know, if we put our Western Wall back out today for our I Believe. We put this out several times, you know, sometimes once a year, sometimes we skip a year and we'll put it out. But this is our prayer wall, all right? And it's just symbolic. It's an actual picture of the Western Wall in Jerusalem. Those stones from that wall. And if you've ever been to Jerusalem and you went up that wall, you'll notice, in fact, if you look at the picture, when you look out, get close to it, you'll see these little pieces of paper. People come in, they write their prayers down and stick them in the wall, you know, as a reminder. I want to ask you today to come up here in just a minute. I know I'm driving the camera guys crazy. You can go ahead and kill it at this point if you want to end the video. There's pencil.